This is a tough task, to have a dialogue, but even to introduce Governor Cuomo is never easy. The one thing I can say is we're all very fortunate because he is indeed a good friend of the Y and has been here on many numerous occasions. But nevertheless, I want to share just a couple of introductory remarks to remind us of the role he has played in New York City, New York State, and in America. He was the longest serving Democratic governor in the modern history of New York State and won the two largest electoral victories ever. His 12 years of service were marked by socially progressive legislation and improvements, including the country's most extensive drug treatment network, the largest program of housing assistance, and a nationally recognized plan for AIDS prevention and treatment. He has been described by the National Review, and this is important particularly because it's the National Review, as a philosopher king and the humble conscience of the Democratic Party, a formidable, saintly genius of liberalism. That is the nicest thing I think the National Review has ever written about anybody. He was born in Jamaica, Queens, at the height of the Depression to Italian immigrant parents. He went on to attend St. John's University first as an undergraduate and then as a law student. Since leaving public office, Mr. Cuomo has returned to the practice of law, specializing in national and international corporate law. He also serves as co-chairman of the Partnership for a Drug-Free America alongside former Secretary of Education and Drug Czar, Bill Bennett. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Governor Mario Cuomo. In a number of your writings, and people who know you well have told me that you were deeply influenced by a Jesuit priest, a man named Teilhard de Chardin. Am I pronouncing it correctly?
It's close. Teilhard, I guess.
Teilhard. How did he influence you? How did you come to know his work, and how did he influence you?
Well, first of all, before I answer that, I think I want to give a plug to Rabbi Talushin's new book, The Book of Jewish Values, which he just gave me. And it looks very interesting, and it's instructive even for this event, I noticed, Rabbi. Because I looked at the titles here. I am now in the practice of the law, and which is a significant way to earn a living. And day two, the instruction as to ethics. Let your fellow's money be as precious to you as your own, you know, which is an interesting instruction. And then day 20, don't speak unless you have something to say. So if some of your answers are replied to by embarrassing silences, you'll know it's because of the rabbi's book. Teilhard influenced me and many other people from the mid-1950s on, especially people who were old-fashioned Catholics, as I was. I was a pre-Vatican II Catholic. Now, if you're a pre-Vatican II Catholic in this country, you grew up with a religion that impressed you mostly with guilt and repentance. And the world was seen as a series of moral obstacles. And your mission in life was to detach yourself as much as possible from the things of this world. It was almost a Calvinistic view of Christianity. The big thing was sin. The thing that was impressed always on you was sin and the avoidance of sin. And the world was perceived more or less as a negative. You had to find a way to live this annoying interval, the period between birth and eternity, in a way that would not cause you to forfeit the heaven to come. That was the old religion. In the mid-50s, a Jesuit priest and a paleontologist who was involved in the discovery of Peking Man and a brilliant, brilliant philosopher began writing, and he wrote books like The Phenomenon of Man and a book called The Divine Milieu, and he wrote only in French. And his writings were banned for a long time because they were regarded not as heretical, but as so different in nuance and emphasis. And the basic difference made all the difference to somebody like me and to some other people like myself. The divine milieu, for example, begins with a line from Genesis. God made so loved the world that he made man. And the proposition, the first proposition, and the most important proposition in Teilhard's book and in Teilhard's view of our theology was, it is wrong to regard this world as some kind of cruel joke or even some kind of battleground or testing area. That your mission should be to get to be part of the world as intimately as you can. And actually, you should be a collaborator in creation. God made the world but didn't finish it. In a way, that came off very modern and very different. It changed your attitude entirely. Instead of being afraid of the things of this world, you should engage in this world. God didn't make it as a test. God made it as a joy. There would be challenges along the way. And it got a lot closer to the Judaism we borrowed when we started Christianity, because it got closer to tzedakah and tikkun olam, and the basic instruction to the Jew that your mission is to repair the universe.
And it's interesting that he picked
And that's where Teilhard wound up. And so his was a positive religion, a positive, not in any way heretical. He didn't depart from any of the dogma, the real dogma, but put an entirely different emphasis on it. And so now it was all right to get to be a politician. It was all right to get yourself as involved as possible in the things of the world. That's what God wanted. Only try to use them in a way to make things better. That was the influence that he hoped to have on people, and that I hope someday I can say he has had on me.
It's interesting, by the way, that he picked up on the theme from Genesis, because Genesis has that striking positive theme, because in the opening chapter of Genesis, seven times in the opening chapter, God saw what he created and he declared that it was good. Now, you're saying in a way it cleared the way for one to be a good Catholic and go into public life. I think if you'll know more about this than mine, but my gut feeling is it cleared the way for a good Catholic to go into public life in a more liberal posture, because I think there had been no shortage of Catholics in public life who often represented, I think, more conservative views. Am I wrong in that? I mean, the Catholic Church was very identified, certainly, until the last half century, with basically being seen much more conservative.
Well, the Catholics were conservative in the period when they were Calvinist in their in their emphasis. They were conservative when, before the Teilhard and before the last few decades, the emphasis was on guilt and repentance. Mm-hmm. That is the conservative impulse. That's the Christian coalition. You know, sin and an emphasis on what sin is and prohibition. And that, of course, is a part of our religion, prohibition. But the affirmative injunction to go forward and to love, as a matter of fact, our religion starts from a rabbi who founds the religion. And when challenged on the road by the scoffer and the disdainer, who said, "Rabbi, I understand you were dazzling them in the temple. What is it that you said that was so clever? Mm-hmm. And can you give it to me in a 15-second commercial?" He said, "I will. Love one another as you love yourself for the love of me, and I am truth. And the truth is that God made the world but did not complete it, and you ought to love one another and together finish the work of creation." And somebody said, "But that's tikkun olam." And he said, "I told you I was a Jew." And he was. So that was the positive injunction. Now, the old Catholic politician is described by some Catholics this way, Fishhooks McCarthy. This is at the edge of being sacrilegious. Fishhooks McCarthy was Al Smith's right-hand man, and he was a politician. And a priest once described Fishhooks McCarthy as a politician who started his day the same way each day, and that was on his knees in a church praying, "Oh, Lord, give me health and strength. I'll steal the rest." So politics was not thought of as an exalted profession at all, even for the Catholics who got involved in it, even for Al Smith. Politics was always regarded in those days as, you know, maybe a little bit too much involved in the things of this world, and that was a negative. It shouldn't ever have been regarded as a negative. That is an insult to the God that created the place, and I think Teilhard's emphasis is more positive and more appropriate. And so it's easier to be a politician within the parameters of our religion today than it was 40 mm-hmm. or 50 years ago, if you took your religion seriously.
Mm-hmm. Religious Jews find themselves, for example, very much bound by Jewish law. Sometimes they'll go to a rabbi if they want something clarified. What is the nature of your relationship as a committed religious Catholic? How do you regard the Pope? And to what extent
as Polish, mostly.
And to what extent do you, let me ask it to you two different ways. To what extent does traditional Catholic theology believe that a Catholic must obey the Pope's teachings? And to what extent do you believe that you need to obey what the Pope says?
That's like asking a rabbi what the Jewish teaching on heaven is. And what you get when you ask most rabbis, maybe it's different here this evening, what do you teach about the hereafter and eschatology? Mm-hmm. You know, there are various answers to that question. So too with authority. I think I can come fairly close to what the Catechism says. Now, we have the benefit or the burden of a bureaucracy and a structure that is authoritarian and tells us what our dogma is. I don't think Judaism mm-hmm. has that. You have the rabbis, and you have the Torah, and you read, and you interpret, and you come to conclusions.
And you have one pope, which is why you don't have Reform, Conservative, and Orthodox Catholicism.
That's right. Right.
Now, they're Catholics, our pope, and lapsed Catholics.
Our pope is the CEO of the church, and the College of Cardinals is the legislature. The College of Cardinals, the Curia, mm-hmm. and the pope, theoretically, make all the laws, but they make very, very few laws. They don't mm-hmm. do a lot of work in dogma. When they do make a principle, for example, you cannot take interest for the lending of money. That is usury, and usury is against the natural law. Usury is a sin. That was a law that came out of the Vatican and was a law, I guess, for 800 years, 900 years. Another law. Conception begins after 40 days, and then life begins. That was law in the Augustinian days. It's no longer law. So it is wrong to say that the Catholics believe that every law they legislate is infallible, because they have repealed and amended many of the laws that were once held to be absolutely sacrosanct. There is a theory that the Pope can speak on some subjects ex cathedra, which means he can put on it the mark of infallibility. This you must believe. We cannot make a mistake about it. There are maybe two such that I'm familiar with. Jesus was God, period. If you don't believe that, you're not Catholic. That's one of them, and that's the principal one. All the others, we are bound to show respect for if we can, et cetera, et cetera. But really, and I don't pretend to be a theologian, but and if you want to be a member of the church, you live by the church rules. Abortion is taught as a principle of natural law. But today they teach that conception begins life begins immediately upon conception. They once taught 40 days.
When did that change happen?
That changed a couple of centuries ago. A few centuries ago. Mm-hmm. But it did change. And do you receive the instruction of your church? Well, yes, you are required to live by the rule of the church. What if you don't agree with it? Well, then you declare yourself out of the church and you give up the benefits of being in the church. Does it mean that Martin Luther could not go to heaven? Well, for a long time, Catholics mm-hmm. were taught by some priests that, yes, that means you forfeit the right to heaven. If you're not in the club, you don't get a pass to heaven. Mm-hmm. That is very old and obsolete and discredited theology. The Catholics teach basically that the ultimate test for a person's goodness is the person's conscience. And if the conscience is well made, which is to say, if you're not fooling yourself, if you really thought sincerely about it, and you honestly come to the conclusion that this or that is the proper course, and you follow the proper course, no God would be cruel enough to punish you for doing what you honestly believed was right, without, you know, playing games with your conscience. So it is a kind of reasonable religion. Now let's be candid. The disadvantage of having a formal religion that involves a bureaucracy of human beings who are administering it is just like the political system. When the human beings are imperfect, when they're narrow-minded or short-sighted, when you get a pope who's capable of the Crusades or capable of the Inquisition or capable of madness, as some of them have been, then you're bound to get certain instructions, etc., that are not intelligent, not reasonable, and by the church's basic principles, not even accurate. And that has happened, and it will happen in any system in which human beings are installed. Mm-hmm. And if you accept that only once or twice in history did they speak ex cathedra, that is infallible, that means all the other time you're subject to their humanity. And so they can make mistakes. And my church has made mistakes. I think one of the glories of the Catholic Church, frankly, and this came up in the course of impeachment, and I wrote an article. The first article I wrote on possible impeachment in this country was, remember, that whatever happens on the impeachment, and I was very much against it for all the wrongness of the president's act, I said, remember, this country is much stronger than the president. And the idea of a Republican democracy that we've lived with for 200 years will survive whatever we do here. And we've survived a lot of presidents who were not great men, and we always will, because of the powerful idea we live by. So too with my church. For 2,000 years, the principle of Christianity, as I understand it, which is basically you're supposed to love one another, and you're supposed to do good for one another, and you are supposed to regulate your own conduct in such a way that you don't hurt anybody. And that's the basic sin, is hurting another individual. There are personal sins like avarice and greed and lust and hate, which you can commit without ever touching another human being, just feeling evil. But that's evil mostly because it's liable to lead to action.
Well,
on that particular note, I want to ask you then. You don't believe that the actual feeling of certain emotions, which are, for lack of a better term, bad emotions.
Bad emotions?
Well, lust, greed, etc., if they don't lead to the actual act, how terrible is it for the person to have those emotions? The reason
you're
asking
Mario, or you're asking me to give you the Catholic teaching? Let me tell you what I would tell
you.
Let me tell you what I would tell my child. I think if my child had been dumb enough to ask me, which none of them were.
Thanks a lot.
They regard. No, they weren't about to ask a pre-Vatican Council II Catholic questions about these things.
It took a rabbi.
No, rabbi, I don't know about you, but when I got married, so you understand what a pre-Vatican Catholic II is. I mean, I gave you this kind of aseptic definition, but let me give it to you really. When I got married, we had a pre-Cana conference. Matilda and I went to the pre-Cana. Cana was the wedding feast story of the Bible, the New Testament. And at the pre-Cana conference, they would explain to you what marriage was. And that meant if you were a good Catholic, they had to give you the details of, you know, the intricacies of the first night and the honeymoon. And they'd give you a book. And it had pictures in it and diagrams. And most of the time they would say, you read the book and don't worry, everything else will take care of itself. And then you'd go on your honeymoon with a little flashlight and a little book. I think I would say, for example, lust. I would say, look, if you have an idea, if you have a feeling, a desire for a woman who is not your wife, or a desire for a woman and you're not married, it's a very natural impulse. It was put there by nature. It's part of the whole cycle of regeneration, et cetera, and the way it's done in our particular kind of animal kingdom. And what you should do is try to put it down as quickly as you can, unless you can implement it properly. And if you can't, by your light, you know, respond to it in a way that you think is appropriate, then try to get it out of your mind. It certainly is not sinful for you to have received the impulse, you'll have an impulse to hate. And one of the things I'm unhappy about with the way even we Catholics treat our own religion is we're inclined to talk, and Christians generally are inclined to talk more about the prohibitions than the, you know, affirmations. And so we're constantly talking about things like sin. And when you talk about values, family values, and the Christian right, or Christians generally talk about values in political life, what do they talk about? They talk about abortion. They talk about Monica Lewinsky. They talk about sex, mm-hmm, basically. Mm-hmm. But there are other things, mm-hmm, even worse things, like hate. And you will get an impulse to hate. You will in your life get a feeling that this is a person I really, I wish her evil. I hope she fails that examination. I hope she gets sick. That to me is probably the worst of all the private sins.
Is all hate wrong?
I think all hate, if what hate is, I wish you evil. I think that is very, very wrong.
Would you feel that of Stalin, of Hitler?
Well, now, you know, I'm against the death penalty because I also think the death penalty is very wrong. And the question I was asked was about the death penalty. It was the same question Mike Dukakis was asked, and really brought him down in the second debate. And I had three people commuted. I mean, there were three cases I handled pro bono. The first time we had a death penalty in this country, which was before 1973 or 4, and I was practicing law, and one of them was a young Jewish fellow, incidentally, who was the second to last person in the death house at Sing Sing. And we succeeded in having him commuted after 7 years. And I was asked, well, Governor, you feel so strongly about the death penalty. What would happen if somebody touched Matilda or one of your daughters? And you were there. I said, I'd probably kill them or try to kill them. I'd probably pick up a baseball bat or whatever I had and destroy them if I could. I'd probably kill them. That would be my natural impulse. I'm no saint. I have a temper. But you shouldn't make a law that reflects your worst impulse. How would you feel about Hitler or Eichmann?
Vis-a-vis hate.
Your instinct would be to say this person is a hateful person. And your instinct would be to destroy him with your own hands if you could. That is not the best instinct. You should do everything you could to end his activity, whatever that hateful activity is. But no, you shouldn't entertain the hate. That is not to say you shouldn't act very aggressively as they did. And Israel, as you know, gave up the death penalty after the Holocaust, except for genocide. They made that exception. So, but how do I feel about entertaining hate? I think it is a wrong thing to do. That is not to say that you permit hateful activity and that you don't fight that aggressively and punish it severely. But hate, the desire to see other people hurt, which is a very human thing, is one of our great weaknesses, maybe our greatest weakness, much greater, I think, than lust.
I just want to backtrack to what you were saying for a moment because I want to make sure that I understood you correctly. You said people asked you, what if somebody was attacking someone very dear to you, you know, a family member?
Well, no, attacking is too easy. Attacking, you defend, you know.
And you're right. The issue is, when you said I'm no saint, you meant that you might even kill the person.
Absolutely.
I'm not saying that would be
a good thing to do. I say the natural reaction, I think, and knowing myself, I get angry thinking about it. You know, I didn't like guys taking my daughters out, frankly. I would be a model of appropriate behavior in a situation like that.
But why is that inappropriate?
It is inappropriate. To kill someone in anger, of course it's inappropriate.
To have killed Hitler in anger or Stalin in anger?
Well, to kill anybody in anger is inappropriate. Anger is a loss of rationality.
Okay, what would be appropriate? Because what many people don't know about your position on capital punishment was, and I happen to be pro-capital punishment, but I thought the position you offered, I was very angry that the Republicans didn't accept. Because your position was you wanted premeditated murderers to, if I'm correct, to serve a life imprisonment without parole.
We are absolutely without parole, correct.
Okay. Which I felt made sense, because in any case, the percentage of murderers who are executed is infinitesimally
small. Absolutely correct.
And I think if that, in fact, happened, what you wanted, it could be a deterrent. What's the rationale why you would have wanted, let me ask you, I want to understand this, a premeditated murderer would get life imprisonment with no possibility of parole. Let's say that the person at some point seemed to have truly repented. What would be the logic of not, at that point, allowing the person out, except for some element of hate or something? What was your logic then?
Well, my logic was the only way to get rid of the death penalty would be to offer people life imprisonment without parole. Mm-hmm. It's as pragmatic as that. Once you said to them that you were going to have what you have now, which is a system that allows some of them out after 7, 8, 9, 10 years. Once you tell the people that, it's too much for them to take, because here is a person who has proven to be capable of killing one or two or 30 people, and you're going to permit him back on the street or commit him or her back on the street, and that people will not accept, nor should they accept. The thing about life imprisonment is not that it's lenient. Life imprisonment is a much worse punishment than death for most people. Now, I can prove that to you anecdotally, but I can prove it to you. A client I had, Habib Riyad Hawa, French Foreign Legionnaire, who killed somebody in a classical felony murder. That was the law at the time, holding up a store in Harlem. Conflict, gun goes off, person dies, felony murder. And he sentenced to the electric chair, he's commuted. And objects that I got him commuted, because commutation then meant 25 years. He says, I don't want to spend 25 years in jail. Forget about it. He says, I want to be executed. And they didn't execute him. They ignored his plea. In 1994, the death penalty was a very big part of a campaign that I lost. And there was one individual who was called back to Oklahoma. The governor of Oklahoma asked that we send him back to Oklahoma because he had been guilty of a murder there and guilty of a murder here, and they wanted to execute him. And I said, no, first he has to serve his time here. He's serving time. When he's finished his time, I'll send him to Oklahoma. And the governor of Oklahoma said, no, Keating. He said, no, you're just trying to avoid the death penalty. I said, look, the law, yes, I'm trying to avoid the death penalty, but the law is the law. Let him serve it here. The guy, the defendant, pleaded to go to Oklahoma. And when the new governor took over, George Pataki, first thing he did was let him go to Oklahoma. And the night before he was executed, he wrote a letter that was published in the New York Post that said, Mario Cuomo, and he spelled my name wrong, was right. He said, the life in prison without parole would be much worse than the death penalty. And he happily went to his execution because he didn't want to follow. He didn't want to stay even 25 years in prison. So I think as a practical matter, it is very severe. But what does it save you? You never kill an innocent person. And if you do get a case like Reuben Hurricane Carter or 50 documented cases of people who died who were innocent, the governor of Illinois, a Republican conservative was very much for the death penalty, has now called a moratorium on it. Other governors are considering doing it. Jesse Ventura has sworn off the death penalty. Why? Because they have discovered that people are being executed who are innocent. Now, even if that's just one person, how do you justify it? Unless you could say, well, it deterred other murders, but it doesn't. Everybody knows it doesn't deter, except the individual you kill. But that you could do by locking him up for life, letting him come out an hour a day. That's what incidental life imprisonment without parole is.
Okay, but that's what I'm not following then in what you're saying, because I want to just figure this out. Because I seem to be picking up two disparate elements. One, you said that you somewhat supported that position of life imprisonment because it was the only way you could guarantee.
Yes.
But now you are indeed raising the other issue that
cruel it is.
Yeah, that it truly serves as a deterrent because that person can't kill again, because there really is data on released murderers who've committed a fair number of murders. So what would you if you didn't have to make any calculations, you didn't have to deal with an opposition Republican thing, you could have determined what the policy would be. What would you? You see, the opponents
life
of the death penalty.
I would still conclude life imprisonment without parole, because you shouldn't take a life. You shouldn't take a life as long as you have a more appropriate punishment and you can avoid it. And mm-hmm. I would make it life imprisonment without parole. Now, the basic thing you achieve is you avoid taking an innocent life. Mm-hmm. I don't think you should take even a guilty life. I have problem even with genocide. I mean, I think we should feel about life a reverence so great that, you know, you should not take it at all under any circumstances except in self-defense. And that gets you back to deterrence. If you had to kill this person because it's the only way to deter him, then you'd have to kill him. Is there a moral? Is this a Catholic teaching? It is not. The Catholic teaching, now the Catholics are saying very openly, and this is interesting politically, we have all this argument now, McCain and Bush, you know, you insulted the Catholics, you know, you called the Pope, and it's such nonsense. I mean, it's so irritating to me that they're trying to run by proving that Bush is a bigot toward the Catholics. Bush is not a bigot toward the Catholics. His brother is a Catholic. I don't know if he's smart enough to be a bigot toward the Catholics. If you were serious about insulting your religion as Catholics, then I think what we Catholics should be saying is, hey, look, I'm a Catholic. My Pope says the death penalty is inappropriate. Where are you on what my Pope teaches? Look, I'm a Catholic. My bishops of the United States of America say that the one thing we should all do politically is make sure that those 38 million people who are still poor in this most affluent of societies, that something is done about them. 38 million. We have more than we had in 1987. They need a little more help. Now,
that's a powerful point, but it seems to me you can get subjected to the charge that gets subjected to any Jew who breaks in any way with Orthodoxy to be accused of picking and choosing. I mean, because if you're suddenly saying that you're coming to those positions because that's what if you challenge a Catholic, how can you be pro-capital punishment? The church now says this. How can you do this? Obviously, you know what's going to get thrown in your face. The church is as adamant about the issues of abortion.
Well, the church says that...
And against birth control. Take something that seems, I think, harder in my mind to justify, you know, against birth control.
The church says that the state should not kill, and that's church teaching. The state says that nobody should take the life of a fetus from birth. Mm-hmm. And so I, as the state, as the governor, will not take the life of a fetus. I would never even imagine passing a law that says we should have abortions because we have too high a population in this country and we can't afford it, as some nations have done.
No, but you did everything in your power as a governor to not allow capital punishment. Would the church have wanted you to do everything in your power to subvert the possibility of abortions being performed?
My position mm-hmm. against capital punishment is not a Catholic position. I began to mm-hmm. tell you that the Catholic teaching is, specifically in the Catechism, we should have no death penalty unless necessary. You know, and that to me is a weasel word which makes the prohibition. Now it's popular for them to say, and the Pope has said, and the cardinal has said, death penalty is inappropriate. When I got killed with it in 1994, they weren't saying that. And for the 12 years I was fighting against the death penalty, I never once heard the Catholic Church teaching it. So it's not so much a Catholic teaching. But now let me talk to you about abortion, which is an even more interesting question. There is no question the Catholics teach, without exception, that abortion is wrong, even to save the life of the mother, even in the case of rape, even in the case of incest. It is absolutely wrong. That's what they teach. And so if you wish to be a Catholic, as we did, Matilda and I, you can't have abortions, and you can't do them. Now the church says, on the subject of should you be subject to a law that says no abortion, or your wife, and you're not a believer in Catholic teaching, they do not say as a matter of dogma that as a Catholic governor, I would have to pass such a law. Now, the cardinal wanted me to, and a lot of Catholics wanted me to, and my position was, as a matter of theology, I am not required, because I personally believe it is wrong. I am not required to make it wrong for people who do not share my religion, and I gave examples. Birth control. We teach that birth control is wrong as a matter of natural law. That's Catholic teaching. I am not required to strip my budget of money for birth control devices for people who are not Catholic. I said, as I understand the Constitution and the state law, the strength of this country is you protect our freedom to believe in whatever religious beliefs we want to. And unless that freedom is going to limit or hurt another human being, I am not going to impose the restriction on you. Now, as to whether the fetus is a human being, Roe against Wade has defined that for us, defined it not the way we did in pre-Augustinian times and not the way we do now as Catholics, but Roe against Wade defines it, says women can have abortions in the first 6 months, the last period, only under very narrow circumstances. Mm-hmm. So that subject is taken care of by the Constitution. And I don't have the right to amend that. If you want to amend that, you need a constitutional amendment. Or the Supreme Court has to get rid of Roe against Wade, which is a monstrous thought, because I don't know what they would substitute for. If they substituted the Catholic teaching, it would be an absurdity in this country, because nobody would live up to it. Catholics today have abortions at the same rate as everybody else does. So the abortion issue is a little bit different than the capital punishment position.
Governor, though, if you believed, not only theologically, but intellectually, outside of theologically, that the fetus was the equivalent of full human life, why wouldn't you want that legislated?
Well, I could urge you to believe that if I thought that that's something that, you know, is a good rule, et cetera, et cetera. And I would want you I would like to try to convert you to that belief. And I suggested in a speech I gave on this at Notre Dame, which was the single most definitive statement ever written politically. I'm not saying it was a good statement, but it was the only time I'm aware of anybody ever said, here's everything I believe on abortion, it's in writing, now you go attack it. And priests did, and cardinals did, and bishops did, and theologically it stood up. And practically, I think, frankly, it stood up, because you don't hear this argument anymore the way you did in 1984 when I was in the middle of it. And what I said there to Catholics, and I was talking at Notre Dame, I said, look, if we really believe that this rule of abortion is the best thing for society, which nobody in this society believes, because there's nobody who says you should be against abortion even to save the life of the mother. But if you truly believe that, we should try to teach people it by example. And before we as Catholics should try to get a law that would limit their options, we should start by ourselves prohibiting abortion in our own ranks, which we're not doing. We're having abortion at the same rate as everybody else in this society.
But if that fetus, and I don't want to go too far along, because I want to get back to the Pope.
You're talking about life.
By the way, the Pope, just so you know, not only is he Polish, he and my father come from the same hometown in Poland called Częstochowa. And I was just reading actually a biography about him, George Weigel, and his relationship to the Jews in Poland pre-Holocaust. Very, very powerful. If one believes that the fetus is human life, as much as, say, a 10-year-old child, and you believe that someone who, God forbid, were to murder a 10-year-old child should be punished, and that 10-year-old child is the same in your eyes, if it is, as the fetus, why wouldn't you want someone punished for destroying another human life?
Well, you see, you answer the question by saying it is human life.
I'm asking.
Well, yeah, but see, when you say the fetus is human life,
if you believe
then you've
that.
Answered the question, because now you've made the fetus the same as a person who is out of the womb and walking around. And that's a very difficult proposition. There is a difference between accepting it as a teaching, whether you can understand it or not, and say, I will live with this because I want to be a Catholic and I want to remain a Catholic. There's a great difference between that and saying, and I believe this is a rule so obviously good that I should impose it upon a pluralistic society that doesn't agree with me and doesn't accept the truth of this proposition because it just doesn't make sense in the terms that they use to intellectualize things. So I don't feel any obligation to incidentally, that's not the only thing that is in that category. I, as a Roman Catholic, am required to believe that any use of contraceptives is against the natural law, a law so obvious that no reasonable person could disagree with it. My church teaches that. The College of Cardinals almost unanimously voted against it, saying it's absurd to say that, but the Pope, like Abraham Lincoln, simply, you know, ignored the ruling, and therefore we still live with a church that says it is a sin against the natural law. I wouldn't dream, as a governor, of saying to people in this community, young people especially, this is against the natural law and you're required to live by it because I live by it. That doesn't make any sense. Now, let me give you another example, slavery. The church always taught that slavery was wrong. But in the mid-1800s, the mid-19th century, the Catholic bishop in this area had slaves. Most priests had slaves. Some rabbis had slaves in the north. Well, didn't the church teach slavery was wrong? Of course they did at that time. Well, why didn't the Catholic Church take it on as a political issue? For the very good reason that it was impractical, and they called it not a prudent application. And so, well, then, what would you have said to them, Rabbi? That's slavery. That's living human beings, not a fetus, which once you said would not be human for 40 days, then you said, no, now. Now, this is a human being, a real one, just like you.
Let me ask you.
So the rule really is, look, in this country, our gift is a law that will guarantee that you can be a Jew, if that's what you want to be, and I can be a Catholic. And I can believe what I want to believe, and you can believe in your own. That's different than saying, you know, we have the right to impose it on any, or we have the obligation to impose it on anybody, that everybody has to, you're going to become the governor, and everybody has to live kosher, right? That's where it would come out, because this would be a fundamental proposition for you, and you would say, if it's good for me, it's good for everybody.
I would draw a distinction, but I wanted to move on to something else. Yeah, the reason it is because
maybe it's a, circumcision.
Because it's a ritual law, and the other is one with ethical
objection. Bad example.
Tell me if I am hearing you correctly, because obviously I'm trying to hear exactly what you're saying, but I feel I'm picking up a nuance.
Is that because you want to agree with me, Rabbi?
No, I think I agree with you quite a bit. The nuance I think I'm picking up is, and tell me if I'm unfairly reading this into what you're saying, that Mario Cuomo, as a religious Catholic, has received from the Catholic Church the teaching that natural law would regard a fetus as a full human life, and natural law would regard contraception as wrong. But I get the sense that not only do you not want to see that imposed as civil law because you think it would be intolerant to non-Catholics, but I have a feeling your sense of conscience questions that as well. Does your sense of personal Mario Cuomo conscience feel that natural law should dictate that all birth control is wrong?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
And nor did the cardinals. But we live in an authoritarian religious context.
And I gather you feel...
And we accept the ruling, and if you want to live by it, if you want to be in the club, then you have to live by the rule, and so you accept it.
The Pope's going to Israel next month. It's going to receive a fair amount of coverage, both in New York and around the country.
Incidentally, this is one of the great popes of all time.
Mm-hmm. I actually wanted to ask you to comment about that, just your feeling about him and this trip to Israel.
It's an amazing story, this pope. If you read The Shoes of the Fisherman by Morris West, he was once a monk, an Australian, and he wrote a book, The Shoes of the Fisherman. I read it as a kid, and Anthony Quinn made a motion picture out of it. And believe it or not, it was just before John Paul was made pope. And nobody knew who he was. And it said that it was a story about the first non-Italian pope in all these years, and he was from behind the Iron Curtain, et cetera, et cetera. Wow. It was eerie that all of a sudden John Paul II came. He is the most unabashedly political pope in our time, mm-hmm. at least. Political in the sense that he was an anti-communist, mm-hmm. you know, who lived it in Poland, and who was now committed to ridding the world of communism to the extent that he can. Very political in that sense. Extremely conservative dogmatically, mm-hmm. Especially on the sex issues, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera. Dogmatic on the subject of women, et cetera. Nothing liberal about him there. Pope John the 23rd, who was the one who freed mm-hmm. Teilhard for writing, remember with the floppy ears and the big nose, and mm-hmm. he went to the jail at winter.
Listen, he is Christmas. Definitely the favorite pope the Jews have ever had. I mean, John the 23rd is a hero in the Jewish
well,
community.
Well,
deservedly a very
big
hero.
He was my
hero.
Favorite, too. First mm-hmm. of all, he was a kind of rural Italian. He was a very plain-spoken person and a very humble person. And he was smart enough to say that what Teilhard was writing about was exactly right. Mm-hmm. He said, Teilhard de Chardin has a more loving version of our religion, mm-hmm. and we should share it with people. And so he freed the books, and I was able to read them in the mid-50s because of John the 23rd. But John Paul has traveled to more countries, you know, spoken out more times, been personally an absolute model of proper conduct, you know, always gracious, always kind. And now to see him at this age, you know, punishing himself just to take a step. He's very old. He's very weak. There was another religious leader that I got to know a little bit that I would put in a class with him, and that's the Rebbe, the Lubavitcher mm-hmm. Rebbe, Schneerson. I mean, he was a great, great mm-hmm. man. 7 degrees. I mean, one of the best educated people ever, mm-hmm. and a very, very good person. Now, outside of the Hasidic community, you know, he wasn't a terribly popular rabbi mm-hmm. because of the culture, et cetera, et cetera. But John Paul, he is Polish, and if he were Italian, he would have been a perfect pope. But he's a very.
I want to turn. I want to turn a little bit to the world of politics, more generically. You are among a very rare group of people who not only considered running for president but did so publicly, at least in the eyes of so many who supported you. You were urged to run. You chose not to. Now that you can reflect on it some years later, what were the factors that influenced your mind, and what was your life like during that time when you were considering a run for the presidency?
Well, I didn't. I've told the story a number of times here, and it's such a tiresome story that I don't even like going over it, because there really isn't a whole lot to it. I gave a convention speech in 1984. In San Francisco. Nobody could spell my name. You know. Thank you. Thank you very much. And it was well received. And then they immediately start talking about being president. And I really felt like Groucho Marx, you know. I really did, because I made one speech and people writing articles, he should be president. And it was like, what did Groucho Marx say? I don't want to belong to any club that would have mm-hmm. me, you know, because the first thing that occurred to me is this isn't right. You know, they don't even know who I am. I made one speech. I could be a fool. Anyway, that was it. Now in 88, they put me in the polls, and I'm first in the polls. 87, I guess. And Mike Dukakis came and said he wanted to run for president. He says, now, you're first in the polls, Mario, and, you know, I don't know how you feel about it. Obviously, I can't beat you because you've got all the money here in New York, et cetera, et cetera. And I said, Mike, if you really want to run, you should run. Number one, I haven't proven yet what you've proven. He was head of the National Governors Association. He was a very good governor. He had been around before I was. He had been better than I was. And I told him that. I said, if there are other candidates in the primary, I'm not going to support you. I'll take a pass, but if you win, boy, I'll be there for you. And I was. And Mike, unfortunately, was not recognized to be what he really was. He was a very good man, and it would have been a really terrific president. He lost. Now came 90. And I made a critical decision. Andrew said in 1990, don't run for a third term. We're in a recession. State's going down. If you run again, they're going to have you for lunch. Everything's going to be bad. You're going to get unpopular. And I said, that's true. He said, let's quit. We'll run for president. And I said, Andrew, that makes sense, except the state is in trouble. You're absolutely right. I've had 8 good years. I'm in the best position to handle this recession. even if I have to take the heat, I'm going to run. I ran, won again, I was governor. By the time they started talking about the next race, 1991, we were deep in a mess here in New York. I mean, our budget was I had to keep remaking the budget. We had big deficits. We had a recession in New York, started with a real estate recession. In the midst of all of that, I'm first in the polls again. And that's when Bill Clinton and his girlfriend, Jennifer Flowers, they had that tape recorded conversation. Do you remember the tape recorded conversation? That guy Kumo, who's that guy Kumo? I know that Kumo. She said, he looks like mafia to me. You know? She changed her mind after that. She said something nice about me once, and I said I preferred being called mafia by it. But the anyway, and so that was, and in the middle of all of that, somebody at a fundraiser here in Manhattan, a group of people who had been giving me money from my first campaign, who were mostly Republicans but liked me, they were friends, and they just supported me, whatever I did. And one of them said, with Matilda sitting there, Mario, in all the time we've given you money, and it's all these years now, since 1974, you've never once talked about the presidency. Now, Matilda was sitting there, and I said, I've never talked to Matilda about the presidency either, because I've never been in a position to take it seriously. As in 88, I told the caucus, and now the state is in a mess. And he says, but you're first in the Don polls. Don't you think you owe it to us at least to consider it? And then, and Vincent, it was Vincent Albanese, and he turned to Matilda, and he knew her very well, and he says, Matilda, is this true that you never talked about the presidency? She said, not once, ever. Never has been mentioned, not by the kids, not by me. I said that day, I said, we'll take a look at it. Over the next 2 months, we did, and I was shocked. I had a press conference. I said, there were so many people who want to give us money. It looks like, you know, I can do it if I can get the Republicans to make a budget. But I have to make a budget for the state. I have to know I have the budget made, and then I'll go run. Because if I don't have the budget made, I know exactly what will happen. As soon as I leave to give a speech in Illinois about the economy of the United States, there'll be a story in the New York Times that says, you know, no budget, the state's going down the tubes, et cetera, et cetera. But I thought they'd make the budget. Why? Because Bob Novak had written a story that says there are no Marios down south, this guy could never win. Because if he gets down, what he was really saying is an Italian couldn't win. You know, and I knew that that's the way the Republicans thought. If you're really ethnic, and I'm distinctly ethnic, and proud of where I come from, et cetera, and New Yorkers aren't too popular around the country. Mm-hmm. So I thought they would make the budget. They refused to make the budget. We waited till the very last day, and I said this all in a press conference, that you know, I can't, they won't make a budget. Under those circumstances, I can't run. Perfectly intelligent, perfectly reasonable, not something really you could argue with. Because if you tried arguing with me, I'd say, well, what happens if I leave now for New Hampshire? What do you think these guys are going to do? And what happens to the state? I would have had to quit, really, as governor. And that's why I didn't run. Now, nobody understood that. Why? Because from the layperson's point of view, and even from the press's point of view, it got to be such an interesting story and such an interesting tale that what they said was simplistic things like, well, you know, that's silly. Country's more important than the state. That sounds logical, unless you happen to be the governor and you swore to take care of the state and that's your obligation. You know, they just dismiss it by saying, well, you know, and then they started with, you know, the rumors. Well, it must be organized crime. Why? Because I have a name that sounds like a oratorio, you know. And then they said colon cancer was another one. It was getting around. And I complained one day. I said, you know, there's the mafia, there's colon cancer. Nobody has accused me of a 28-year-old girlfriend on the side. Which, you know, since you do it with everybody else, I don't know why you're not doing it to me. And one of my daughters was asked about it and said, some things just lack plausibility, which I thought was... I didn't particularly like that either.
Was that a compliment or?
That's the whole story. Now, so then the question is, well, And I don't like the question because it's this kind of personal thing is not. I mean, it's boring to me, and I'm afraid it's boring to the audience.
It's not boring to the people because people. No, it is a fascinating thing. A fear, you know, because when you first said it, your first instinct in 84 was, this is absurd. What have I done that makes people think that I can do it?
Right.
But I'm sure at some point along the way you started, I have a feeling that you probably have not been overwhelmed by the quality of certain of the people who decided to try and become president. I assume that's what made you, isn't that in part what made you reconsider it?
No. Well, let me tell you this in terms of values, the way I think you should approach the issue. Okay, I think, and to me, this comes very naturally. The idea that you could want from the time you're 14 to be president of the United States, and then say I'm going to be president of the United States because that's what I really want, that does not appeal to me. I know that some people say that that's what's happened to them. But for me to want to be president of the United States, I have to look at you two who are possible candidates and say to myself, I'm better than he is and I'm better than that guy. Mm-hmm. And therefore, or at least I'm at least as good as they are, and then I'll run. Why? Because what you really should feel is that since the whole world is going to be your responsibility, let alone the United States of America, since you're going to be the most powerful person in the world, you have to start by saying to yourself, am I the person to do that job? There are an awful lot of lives that depend upon me. There's the possibility of war that is lurking out there constantly, and a wrong move could create one. So I had better be sure that I'm the right person here. Now, that is the first. And so you should look around. Now, if it happens to be a group that's not, in my opinion, startlingly more capable than I, and 92 I felt that way, 91. You know, I knew Bill Clinton. I knew him well. I had been a governor with him. I liked him, respected him, until the tape recording. But you know, we got along well, and I knew the other people, and they were all bright. But my feeling in 91 was, hey, look, this is New York State. I've been here. I've been here through recessions. I've been here through the AIDS. I've been here through the homelessness. I've been here through the crack. I know it. I was here with the deficits. This I can do. So I felt competent, relatively. Mm-hmm. You know, not. I have no illusions about my ability. I've always thought of myself as an 82. All right, I'm an 82. But these guys were not 90. So, you know, I felt that way. And that's the way you should feel. And see, the idea that you would be attracted to public service because you like the idea that people applaud you, I find I'm very uncomfortable with that, because the truth is they will applaud you when you say stupid things and when you're prostituting yourself. And they will condemn you when you're right, you know, and when you're saying something that's really noble. And I've seen that happen over and over, and it happens to everybody. So the people are not always in the best position to judge. Incidentally, we have a smarter and smarter population. I mean, this population knows a lot about issues, a lot more now than they did 20 years ago, because now it's coming at you on the internet and television, and they're very, very knowledgeable. And this is a good population. I mean, the population of the people of the United States of America are as sound, as honest. You know, we make mistakes. So I would trust them. But they don't have the information, and they don't know. So to me, I miss public service right now. I miss the governor's job. I was talking to the fellow I drove here with, who asked me the question specifically, how do you feel? I miss it. I mean, this is more comfortable. I'm finally making a living. I don't have to worry about Matilda if I drop dead now. I have a big insurance policy. She's all set. I didn't have that when I was governor. But when you wake up as governor, every morning that you wake up, you say to yourself, well, today there are an infinite number of opportunities out there to help somebody, to do something really good for somebody. And man, let me go and see what I can do today. And if you foul up every one of them, and you're lucky enough to wake up the next day, they're still there, and maybe even more. You have this chance at efficacy, this chance to do a little tikkun olam, this chance to make things better on the grandest possible scale. And that is a marvelous, marvelous gift. And to me, at this stage of my life that I was at, you know, when I had finished the fight for survival, and I'd finished, you know, doing the things you have to do for the five kids to make sure that they get a reasonably good start. It's the most important thing in your life if you're a Jew, or if you're a Christian, or if you're a Muslim, or if you're a thinking person. The most important thing left for you is not to fill up your basket of appetites with food or wealth or sex or whatever. That can't be the most important thing. The most important thing is trying to make the place better. What else is there? What other truth is there? And that's the way I feel about public. And frankly, that's why I said no to the Supreme Court of the United States, which was also an easier possibility. And Matilda didn't understand that one at all, and neither did Andrew. But I did not think that the good you could do in the span I would have on the Supreme Court, which gets 70 cases a year, the good you could do is one of nine people, when maybe four or five of those cases were really important every year. The good you could do in voting, et cetera, is not equal to the good you can do just being out there arguing the issues and taking 20 years of experience and going and debating Bill Bennett, which I do, and Alan Simpson in California all last week, and reminding people about the death penalty, none of which you can do on the Supreme Court. As soon as you put that robe on, you put a lock on your mouth and your mind. You can't deal with any of these other issues. I just thought that and maybe helping your son get into public life, which is going to happen.
Do you think then, well, let me ask you, I'll be very specific. Can you give us a quick assessment of the major presidential candidates?
Well, let me tell you first what I think the major issues are. There is one major proposition that I think needs to be established for the American people. We are really hungry for something profound to believe in. We really are. You know, we're at a stage where you know, we've got it made more than anybody in the world. We've got the economy in good shape. We're the only mega military power. We're still the greatest engine of opportunity in world history. If you want to make it, you come here. From wherever you are in the world, you go there, you've got a better shot to make it. So we have it made. But we're still confused about, you know, what really counts. You know, that's why McCain went up like a rocket. Whoa, a hero, somebody who's, you know, he's special. He's giving us something more to believe in here. And people jumped at it. We need a basic truth to believe in, or a hero to believe in. Forget about heroes. We'll have heroes for lunch. There's something about the electronic communication age that has so saturated us with knowledge that we've gotten to the point we think knowledge is wisdom. We think we know everything now, and we're not going to tolerate heroes. So forget about Moses. Forget about some great figure coming in. Then you need a great truth. There's one great truth, and it is similar, if not identical, to the truth that started 5,000 years ago with the Jews. And that is that you will find your greatest individual good in the good of the whole community. It's tzedakah plus tikkun olam. And it is a truth that is not only at the foundation of Judaism, it is the foundation of evolution. There's a wonderful new book out by Robert Wright, the No Zero... Destiny is in the title, but it's a story of creation, mm-hmm. and it's a story how evolution is working its way up toward something better. And some, you know, you start with the slime, and then the fish, and then the vegetation, and you get humans, and now we're civilized, and now we're getting smarter and smarter. It's the principle that created the Articles of Confederation. 13 colonies decide they'd better come together to fight off the British. Then the Constitution tied them tighter together. It's the principle that sent you back to Germany after the Holocaust to rebuild Europe. It's the principle that sent you to Japan after the war to bring them back to life. We're all in this together. We're interconnected and interdependent. And for us to survive, we have to save Russia now. Why? Because we have to avoid chaos. We need trading partners. We have to integrate. We have to synergize. That's the basic truth. In this country, at this moment, that is the basic truth that somebody has to remind us of. And they're not doing it politically. There is an assumption now that things are good, and those pockets of unhappiness, like 38 million people who are poor, 132 million workers out of 165 who are low and moderate skilled, which means they're going nowhere. The average wage is $28,000 in this country for an individual, $39,000 for a family. If you're high skilled, well, then you're doing so well that we import 125,000 computer engineers, immigrants, because we don't train high-skilled people. If you're low or moderate skilled, you're working. You're working. We have low unemployment. But your wages are not going up 1% a year. And if they go up 1% a year, the cost of your health care, higher education, housing, and transportation are all going up 4, 5, 6, 7%. Which means you've got to work extra hours, put somebody else to work, get another job, just to stay even. We're not even talking about that. Why? We're afraid you can't do anything for the weaker part of this country without hurting the stronger part of this country. And everything is a zero-sum game. And we're not willing to make that sacrifice. Right now, you could do everything you had to do to make intelligent investments in health care for 44 million people who don't have it, for old people who can't afford prescription drugs. You have the money, you have the surplus. Without raising taxes, without damaging business, just don't give huge tax cuts back to me and my clients. That's all you'd have to do, is to say no to the tax cut, just no to the tax cut, and you could do all these other things. So that should be our politics. That should be our politics, that we're going to strengthen the whole country. Incidentally, practically, we'd be better off. If you had 30% more high-skilled workers, you'd have a richer nation. If you had fewer people without health insurance, you wouldn't have to worry about these emergency room bills. You would reduce the amount of illness in this country, because 44 million people without a health insurance plan means they don't get health care until they get acutely ill. And if they had a health care plan, there would be preventive primary care. You'd have less money being spent on health care, which is Now, nobody's even talking about this. So the first thing you have to say to yourself is, before you judge these candidates, is judge yourself and the whole political system. Are they talking about the right issues? McCain went up like a rocket. Nobody knew what he stood for except campaign financing. To this day, they don't know where he is on the environment. They don't know what he's going to do about 44 million people without health care. They don't know whether he cares a damn about the poor people. But they love him. Why? He's different. He's new. He's reformed. The special. This is all baloney. He's accusing Bush of hating the Catholics.
It's baloney, but it's a reflection of an interesting thing, you know, which obviously you're very aware of, the extraordinary cynicism about people in politics. I want to ask you a question. You said something a few moments ago that profoundly moved me, and I must admit surprised me, and the extent to which it surprised me made me realize how cynical I am. And I was surprised because I believed you. I mean, you know, and what you said, and I'll tell you what it was. You said the greatness of being governor was that you got up every morning and thinking, what good could I do for people today? And no, I was actually very moved. When I say I believed you because your sincerity is transparent. But I didn't, I must admit, I don't think that people think like that. I don't want to put you in the position of sounding self-righteous. But there are 50 governors, 100 senators, 435 congressmen. What percentage of them do you think do get up in the morning and think among their first five thoughts, not their first thought? So are Americans really being foolishly cynical?
I think a whole lot of them. Mm-hmm. I really don't know. I think a whole lot of them are exactly like me. They haven't had the chance to say it. They haven't had this glorious kind of opportunity mm-hmm. to say it. I think a whole lot of them could have much easier lives by not being in public life. There are, of course, some who just love the limelight and love, you know, mm-hmm. and love all of that stuff about it. But no, I think they are basically very, very good people who are trying to make a difference and who, whether they articulate it or not and whether they even are religious or not, this is an instinct that you have way down in you because it's common sense. You know, let's go back to the rationale here and how it works in your mind. I wrote a letter to the grandchildren, my grandchildren, and it got published out on Long Island. And what it said was this, the new millennium, what would you say to your grandchildren? I would say to my grandchildren, listen, if you learned anything from being in this family, it's how important education is. You know that my mother and father came here, they couldn't read or write, and they killed themselves to make sure I got to school, and I got a very good job, and now I'm making money, and they're even going to pay me for this letter I'm writing you. I said, so you need to be educated. That's the first thing to remember. And you're going to need more education than me because the world is more complicated, so you're going to need more school. Terrific. When you get educated, you're going to be very successful. Because if you get enough education, then there's so much power in this place, you're going to have all the material things, I guarantee you. And then maybe you'll have a family, maybe you won't have a family, but you'll go through most of your life dealing with, the survival things. You know, what do I do now? I have to function a little bit. But at one point in your life, you'll put that all behind you, and you'll stop and you'll say to yourself, why am I here? At one point, you're going to say it. Now, if you're a poor person for all of your life, or if you're like my mother and father, they never had a chance to stop and say, why am I here? That I'm here to put bread on the table, I'm here to get this kid educated, I'm here to pay the bill, boom, they died. And it was over. And they never got to the stage where, you know, what's it all about? They knew what it was all about. Bread, shelter, and a lot of people live that way. But some of us are not that lucky. And we have to face this question, what is it all about? Now, what are your choices? What is it all about? The one most obvious one is, have as much fun as you can. You know, mm-hmm. Now you're 60, how much fun can you have? For how long? And if you did it, if you ran as hard as you could to do all the things, to eat all the bonbons, to have all the drinks, to do all that other stuff, what you're going to find is your appetites are withering and your capacity to fill them up is withering. And at that point, I think maybe what you're going to conclude, and it'd be better if you concluded first, that the only thing that matters is being part of something and trying to make it better. Now, before you tell me that how much good can a little person make, understand that whatever force put it here, and I think it was a God, and we'll call it God, that force must have been smart enough to know how complicated the problem is and how little you are. So that force is not going to expect a whole lot of you, and you shouldn't expect too much of you. Just do everything you can to your best. Mm-hmm. And as your efficacy grows, then you do more. If you're lucky enough to get to be a big shot, then you do big things. And if you're not, you do the little things as far as you can. Make one person happy, that's all you can do, I'll settle for it. That at least gives you something to live for. That gives you a value. Then you can say, at least I'm in the right army, fighting the right battle, marching in the right direction. And when you drop dead, you've got some vindication. If you don't have that, if you don't believe in that, you drop dead, you're ashes. Maybe worse. Maybe there is a place where they're going to punish you for not believing in the first place. So that to me should be that should be the basis of our political values too.
I will say though, that the integrity that even your detractors speak about somehow was always communicated and clear to anybody listening to you, wherein I do think that the skepticism, even if in the hearts of many people in political office today, there is a deep integrity and a deep desire to make a better world, for whatever reason, I don't think it's well communicated the way yours
was. You know why, Rabbi? Let me tell you why. Because the system is such, with this stupid financing problem, for example, mm-hmm. that they are forced to do a lot of things mm-hmm. that make them look cynical. For example, they have to come to you and beg you for money just to keep the position, mm-hmm. just to get the position in the first place. They have to come and ask you for money, and once they ask you for money, they're caught in this terrible bind. Because now when you come back to visit them and say, you know, I gave you $50,000 and I don't want you to do anything corrupt, but my son-in-law, you know, he hasn't been able to keep a job. I put him in a little business. If he could get a license from the state that let him do a little bit over here with the helicopters, maybe he'll make a lot of money. You know, and then all of a sudden you're in the game mm-hmm. because you were required to go to them for money. And then another thing happens. We're caught up in a system now where in order to stay in office to do the right things, you have to convince the population that you're going to do what they want. And you have to become a slave to popularity. Now, being a slave to the polls and popularity sometimes is at war with doing what is best for the community. Here, let me give you a very good example of this. The president's running. I'm unhappy in 1996 with the welfare reform bill, which I think is a disaster. I'm unhappy with some other things because I don't think he's making the most of his opportunity. You should be bolder. You should say education, 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 public school education. I'm going to do what for education what John Kennedy did for space. And I write a speech that says that before the convention. He sees me here at a fundraiser, and I'm in the back of the room. He's up in the front of the room. They're all lining up, shaking hands, putting money in a bag, and then leaving. And it was like an Italian wedding. It was really wonderful. And he sees me, he calls me up, and he chases all of the Secret Service, pushes everybody back, and we're up there, two guys talking and arguing a little bit. He says, "Tell me again, Mario, what you said." Ba-da-boo, da-bee-da-boo. I told him. He put his hands on my shoulders. He says, "You know I love you, right?" I said, "I know you've been very good to me, Mr. President, but I think you really have to do this." He said, "And I believe you're totally sincere." He says, "And nobody says it better than you." I said, "Well, thank you, Mr. President." He said, "But Mario, you lost." He said, "Do you want me to lose?" Mm-hmm. "No," he said, "do you want me to lose?" He says, "Of course you're right about getting those things done. But if I try saying that in this election, I'll lose the darn thing." Mm-hmm. They'll say it's big government again. So that's the bind. Now, my position was, no. If you said educate, they will understand. The people will understand. And then he would have said, "Yeah, how come they didn't understand you on the death penalty?" So they're in a bind. They have to do, the president is very much like me, I think, in the things he would like to see done. But I think he made a practical judgment that he couldn't get it done. He couldn't win by promising those things. Therefore, he made the practical concession. And I think they're all doing that now. Bill Bradley is the one who came closest to asking for the big things, right? And what happened to him? Boom, he got wiped out. I mean, he has made no mark at all. And he's asking for a big health care plan, which frankly we need. But it does not sell. And so there is this frustration that the politicians face. And in fairness to them, I think we ought to acknowledge that.
We could obviously spend a lot more time with you, and we'd love that opportunity. Before I thank you, I have a couple of just brief comments. One is, this turns out, Joseph, that this is our 25th of Forum on Contemporary Values. We started this program 9 years ago. Our first one was with Elie Wiesel. And it's befitting to have you at the other end. We hope to do this again for, God willing, a lot of years to come, but somehow the 25th has some significance. It's also significant because, so many of you know Joseph. You know him by his books. He has written the most widely used books in Jewish life on important events and practices of Judaism. He has just written this book, The Book of Jewish Values. It is a very new perspective. They are basically one or two page daily ethical activities from Jewish sources literally every day of the year. You will learn ways to be kinder and deeper and, dare I say, a better human being as a result. It is a book that literally can transform the way you live your daily life with insights into parent-child relationships, to business ethical considerations, the ethics of speech. As the way I've come to put it, Judaism is not only interested in what goes into your mouth, but what comes out of your mouth as well. And actually, Joseph, if maybe you would just give an example of, I love the first entry in your book, so people will get a sense of what the points you make are.
Okay, I'll be brief. This is, I feel anticlimactic here at this point. But Devorah and I, my wife and I, were living for 2 years in Boulder, Colorado, and I became friendly there with Rabbi Zalman Schachter. And I once said to him, "You know, there's something about my life in New York that I'm embarrassed about." I said, "Very often you'll be in Manhattan, you're having an intense conversation with someone, and suddenly it's interrupted by the sound of a siren, an ambulance siren. And my first reaction is annoyance, and I know it's inappropriate. So Zalman gave me advice 3 years ago that I followed ever since. He said, no matter what you're doing, stop whatever you're doing and make a prayer. If it's an ambulance, maybe make the prayer that Moses makes when his sister Miriam becomes sick, El na rafan Allah, oh God, please heal her. If it's a fire truck, pray that they get to where they're going in time. No one loses their house, no one's hurt, no fireman's hurt. If it's a police car, they get there in time. I started doing it and a few things happened. Number one, I stopped being annoyed. I had something to do. But what really happened was, for the first time in my life, it helped me to start practicing the law of love your neighbor as yourself, even when I didn't know who my neighbor was. It expanded the number of people I knew. It occurred to me, can you imagine if this became widely known? If people knew that they, when they were in an ambulance going to the hospital, wherever they, the ambulance passed, people were praying for them? So it just struck me as one example, and that's why I opened the book with it, but I really wanted to try and find some activity people can do every day, because the cumulative impact can really be transformative in people's lives.
Anyway, the book is literally, it's just one example, literally out this week, and I know that Joseph will be available to sign copies, and I hope you enjoy it as much as I have. I was going to close with a quote of yours, Governor Cuomo, that actually has an irony beyond imagination, because I found it in, of all things, an article that you wrote a few months back in Newsday entitled A Public Letter to Your Granddaughters. Mm. And while you paraphrased it, with your permission, I was so taken with it. I thought it was so beautiful, and the irony couldn't be greater that you actually reflected on it. This is what you wrote. I think there is an idea that can give you all the direction you need, an idea simple enough for everyone to accept, sweet enough to inspire us. It is the idea that is the basis of the Judeo-Christian tradition that helped give birth to America and that helped sustain our nation to this day. It began with the Jewish people about 4,000 years ago, who described it in two Hebrew principles, tzedakah and tikkun olam. Tzedakah means that all of us, wherever we were born, whatever our color or accent, are children of one God, brothers and sisters who owe one another respect and dignity. And the second principle, Tikkun Olam, tells us we should find ways to come together in order to repair the universe, to make it stronger and sweeter. The Christians borrowed both principles. The first we call charity, the obligation to love one another, and the second teaches us, as it taught the Jews, that God made the world but did not finish it, that he left the world to us so that we could, side by side and working together, collaborate in completing the work of creation by making this world as good as it can possibly be. Because God knows how grand the world is and how small we are, he is not going to expect any miracles from you. All he asks is that you do what you can. And you have done a lot. It's been a privilege. Thank you.